Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, we're going to talk about split-brain patients. Now, these are patients who have had their corpus callosum severed. So you might recall that the corpus callosum is this large band of nerve fibers, and it connects the cerebral cortex of the left hemisphere to the cerebral cortex of the right hemisphere. So why would we ever want to sever this connection? Well, for most of these patients, this procedure is done because they have seizures. So they have seizures, which are these bursts of neurons firing, that are sort of uncontrollable bursts of neurons firing, and this spreads, right? So the neurons firing causes other neurons to fire, and then that causes other neurons to fire. And so this ends up spreading sort of back and forth between the two hemispheres, right? So the way to stop this is to sever the connection, the corpus callosum, between these two hemispheres, and this helps to reduce the spreading of this random neuron firing. And the good news is that this procedure is very effective. So if you have a patient who has very frequent seizures, very disruptive, severe, really affecting their ability to live a normal life, then they might undergo this procedure. And this will hopefully stop the seizures from occurring. Now, there are some side effects of severing the corpus callosum. But the other good news is that these side effects are actually fairly small. If you met somebody who had undergone this procedure and had a split brain, you probably wouldn't know. So there wouldn't be really obvious effects on their behavior that would stand out to you. But if you put them in certain situations and tested this, you could see that they had these two separated hemispheres of their brain, unlike a person with an intact corpus callosum where the two hemispheres can communicate with one another freely. Okay, so how do we go about finding these differences in behavior that occur? So it turns out there are some specializations of each hemisphere. So the left hemisphere sort of has certain tasks that it's good at that the right hemisphere doesn't do, and vice versa. The right hemisphere has some tasks that it's specialized for that the left hemisphere doesn't do. And this is work that was done originally by Roger Sperry, studying split-brain patients. And for this, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1981. And in fact, that year, it was a split Nobel Prize because he shared it with David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel, who we're going to learn about in a future video, because they did work on visual processing that's also relevant for psychology. Sperry did this initial work on these hemispheric specializations, right? These certain tasks that are specialized in either hemisphere. So what are these specializations, and how do split-brain patients reveal them? So the first specialization, and the most important for these split-brain studies, is the idea that language, for most people, occurs mostly in the left hemisphere, and speech production occurs mostly because of activity in the left hemisphere. So this area in the left frontal lobe called Broca's area that coordinates the movements for speech, as well as other language processing areas, are mostly in the left hemisphere. Okay, so what this means is that if we send information to the left hemisphere, we can talk about it. But if we send it to the right hemisphere and we can't get it over to the left hemisphere via the corpus callosum, then we can't talk about it. So how could we demonstrate this with a split-brain patient? Well, let's say we gave them an object to hold. So if I were to place this object in their right hand, remember the idea of contralateral control, this is going to get sent from the right hand to the left hemisphere. So if I ask the person, what are you holding? They'll be able to tell me, you know, if I blindfold them, place it in their hand, and then they say, it's a key, or I think it's a key, right? Because they're grasping it with their right hand, the left hemisphere tries to figure out what it is that they're grasping, and then sends it to the speech production area, and they can tell me it's a key. On the other hand, literally, I can place it in the left hand. The person can't tell what it is. They place it in their hand. They feel it. You know, the right hemisphere is processing this information, saying, I think it's a key. The problem is the person can't say this because the right hemisphere doesn't control language production. So the person knows what it is, but they can't tell me. What is it? You know, I'm drawing a blank. I can't seem to say it. Right? So how do we know that the right hemisphere even knows it? Right? You might say, well, maybe they just really don't know. Well, if I put a bunch of objects in front of them, and I say, okay, using your left hand, point to the one that you were holding, and they can immediately point to the key. So this shows that the right hemisphere does know it, it's just not able to talk about it. Okay, so that's one way we can reveal this specialization in the brain. Now we'll get a little bit more complicated. We're going to look at how this works with visual information, right? Not just touch sensation, which, as I said before, is purely contralateral, right? Left side of the body goes to the right hemisphere. Vision is a little bit more complicated, but not too bad. So I want to go over this, and if you have any questions about this, feel free to ask in the comments, but I'll do my best to simplify this. Okay, so let's say we're looking at the down sort of the top of somebody's head, right? So here's their left eye, and here's their right eye, and then we've got their left hemisphere here, which, right, we're looking down, so it's going to sort of overlap the eye there, but we'll do our best to. This won't be the most anatomically correct brain diagram you've ever seen, but hopefully we'll get the point across. Okay, so here's the left eye, here's the right eye, here's the left hemisphere, here's the right hemisphere. Okay, so the important thing about the eyes is that they process information by visual field. What this means is they're not contralateral the way the rest of the body is. It's not the case that the left eye goes to the right hemisphere or the right eye goes to the left hemisphere. That's not true. It's a common mistake that students make, so banish that from your mind. And what we'll see is it's divided by visual field. So if I focus on the center of the screen here, if everything over to the right is red, and then on the, let's say on the left side I have blue here, what's going to happen is that this blue side, the left side of the screen, is going to go, you know, the light's going to travel straight across to this part of the retina on this eye, right? And same thing on this eye here. And the right side of the screen is going to travel across over here. Now, it goes to the opposite side of the eye because the light is just traveling straight through the hole in the eye, the pupil, and just hitting that opposite side. But the more important thing is what happens after this. So what happens is this information, so the important point is really that the eye is getting two sides, a left visual field and a right visual field. Okay, so what happens then is this information comes out from here, right, comes out the optic nerve. And in this case, it's the right visual field, and it's already in the left hemisphere, so it's going to actually stay in the left hemisphere. Actually, be a little shorter. All right, so it's going to go initially to an area called the optic chiasm, then it goes to the thalamus, and then the thalamus sends it out to the appropriate area of the cortex, which in this case is the occipital lobe, to the primary visual cortex. Okay, now what's interesting is what happens over here on the other side is this right visual field needs to get over to the left hemisphere. So in this case, it comes out the optic nerve, and when it gets to the optic chiasm, it actually crosses over to the other hemisphere and joins this information, which is also about the right visual field, and then gets sent out to the occipital lobe for processing. And the opposite would be true over here. So this side, the left visual field, is going to go down here out the optic nerve. It's going to get to the optic chiasm, but it's already in the right hemisphere, so it stays over here, goes to the thalamus, and then goes out to the occipital lobe for processing. And over here, this left visual field is going to kind of come out here, and when it gets to the optic chiasm, it's going to cross over to the other side, to the right hemisphere, then go to the thalamus, and then go out to the occipital lobe for processing. So what this means is that everything in the right visual field goes to the left hemisphere, and everything in the left visual field goes to the right hemisphere. Right? So this is the right hemisphere over here. It's only seeing blue information. And this is the left hemisphere here, which is getting the right visual field, which is all red. Okay. Now, if you think about this, it makes sense that we would split by visual field instead of splitting by eye. Because if you were to lose an eye, if we think sort of in evolutionary terms about how this is helpful, if you lose an eye, it would be a real shame if that meant that that whole side of the brain was no longer getting any visual information. Right? You'd be wasting all that brain space just because you lost an eye. In this situation, we see that even if you lost an eye, information is still going to get sent to both of the occipital lobes, right? So if we knocked out the right eye here, the left eye would still send some of its information to the right and some to the left, based on visual field. Okay, and let me just add a few labels in here. So this point here would be the optic chiasm. That's where the information crosses over to get to the appropriate hemisphere. And then what I've drawn in here is this is where it's going into the thalamus after the optic chiasm. And then from there, it ends up in the occipital lobe in the primary visual cortex. And this is an area called V1, the primary visual cortex. Okay, so let's get back to our split brain patients. What happens when we split the corpus callosum here, we sever the corpus callosum, we split the brain, we don't cut the optic chiasm. So this process here still occurs. This transfer from visual field over to the opposite hemisphere still occurs. Okay, so what does this have to do with the split brain tasks? Well, now that means we can do this just like we did with the hand version, right? Except now I put the information on the screen, right? And I have them focus on the center, right? That's important. They have to focus on the center. If they move their eyes around, then they can send everything to both hemispheres. And that's how they're normally going to do it in everyday life, and that's why you aren't going to notice. But if we focus their vision, we flash these on the screen briefly so they don't have time to move their eyes around, sort of see what's going on everywhere, then anything to the right goes to the left hemisphere, and anything to the left goes to the right hemisphere. So if I flash these on the screen, right, the screwdriver is going to my left hemisphere over here. So when you ask me, what did you see on the screen, I flash these there, and if I have a split brain, I'm going to say, I saw a screwdriver, because that's all the left hemisphere saw, the right visual field. Right? If, however, you ask me to draw with my left hand what I saw, well, the left side of the screen went to my right hemisphere, which is going to tell my left hand to draw a key. Now, the really interesting thing is when I ask the person, so they draw the key there, and then they look at it, and I say, why did you draw a key? And now I'm asking them to explain, right, using speech. And so the left hemisphere saw a screwdriver, but then sees that the person drew a key. You know, why did this happen? And it turns out the left hemisphere will make up an explanation. It's something that the left hemisphere seems to be good at, is coming up with logical explanations for behavior. And so the person will look at the key and they'll make up some story with the left hemisphere. They say, well, I saw a screwdriver, but last time I needed a screwdriver, I couldn't find one, and so I ended up using a key to turn a screw. You know, they'll make up some plausible explanation to why did I draw key when they saw screwdriver. Okay. It's also the case that there are some things that the right hemisphere does better. So one of these is face recognition. This, for most people, is going to predominantly happen in the right hemisphere. So this means if we show things that are arranged into a face, right, this certain detection of the pattern that makes up a face, rather than the individual parts, is happening in the right hemisphere. And in one of the videos that I've posted in the description, you can see Michael Gazzaniga working with a split brain patient. And he gives him this task where he shows these famous paintings by Archimboldo that perhaps you've seen before, of faces made out of objects, right? So made out of fruit or flowers or books or something like that. And if he shows it to the right visual field, goes to the left hemisphere processes, sees the objects. What did you see? I saw books, I saw flowers. But if he sends that same painting on the left visual field, so it goes to the right hemisphere, now the right hemisphere has this facial recognition area. It can see this pattern. And so the right hemisphere says, I saw a face, right? You point with the left hand. What did you see? The right hemisphere saw a face, right? That sort of stood out to the right hemisphere because it's specialized for recognizing faces. So that's another specialization that can be revealed through these split brain patients. Okay, so the key ideas here to remember are, first of all, that it's split by visual field, not by eye. So keep that in mind. Students often get tricked up by that. And the second point is that this specialization doesn't really matter in daily life. All right, we have these clever experiments revealing these differences between the left hemisphere and right hemisphere, but don't take this too far. There's a lot of books being sold, you know, talking about left brainers and right brainers, and it's, to me, all very silly, because most of us have our corpus callosum intact, and everything is happening in all areas of our brain. The hemispheres are sharing information with each other. Yes, it's true, certain tasks are specialized to the left and right hemisphere, but in terms of how that's going to affect your behavior, it doesn't really matter. So you don't sit there and say, wow, I looked at a bunch of faces today, so my right hemisphere is really tired, or I've been producing a lot of speech, so my left hemisphere is exhausted, but my right, you know, it doesn't really matter that way. I mean, if you want to get good at a certain task, you just practice doing it. You don't need to think about whether that is related to brain activity in the right or left hemisphere. I don't really see the point of that. But I guess it helps to sell books. So that's the other thing to keep in mind. Don't go too far in drawing conclusions from this. And even for people with split brains, it's true that both halves of their brain are very active all the time and coordinated and doing a number of activities, and they're moving their eyes around and sending information to both hemispheres. And so it really doesn't matter too much about which hemisphere processes which information. Okay, so I hope you found this helpful. Check out the videos that I linked in the description. I think you'll find them interesting. You can see some actual split brain patients doing some of these studies. And if you found this helpful, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.